ladies and gentlemen, that is madness. William Shakespeare did not, I repeat, not sign his name into the book of Psalms, the 46th chapter. William Shakespeare did not translate the book of Psalms. William Shakespeare did not translate the Bible. That is just another smear campaign and a tactic used to discredit the Bible. The same way people try to say that King James was a homosexual. That is another smear campaign and a tactic to attack and destroy the credibility of the King James Version Bible. Now, I don't want to go off into a tangent, but since I brought it up, the accusation, for those of you that don't know, that King James was a homosexual was leveled by a political enemy named Sir Anthony Weldon. He was the clerk of the Green Cloth. And what happened was he was expelled for political reasons from the King's court. Now, Sir Anthony Weldon, his family had served for generations in the King's court, so that was an embarrassment that he was expelled. So upon being expelled, he promised to get revenge against the King. Now, Weldon didn't get his revenge against the King in his lifetime. What happened was, when you read the history, Anthony Weldon waited 25 years after King James and his son Charles was dead, and then he began making accusations that King James had confided in friends that he was secretly a homosexual. That's a lie. That is 100% a lie. As a matter of fact, if you know anything about King James at all, you would know that he, as King of England, wrote more books in his tenure than any other monarch of England before him or after him. And one of the most famous books that King James wrote was a book called the Basilicon Doron. And what that was it was instructions for his heirs that would rule after him on how they should rule the kingdom. And particularly, when you go to page 46 of the Basilicon Doron, King James instructed his heir to eschew to be effeminate. The word eschew means avoid. So he told his heir that he should avoid being effeminate. Now, why would a homosexual tell his son not to be effeminate if he was effeminate? Why would he instruct his son to do that? Because he knew it was a sin against God, and he was not a homosexual. And when you turn two pages over in that same book called the Basilicon Doron, here's a quote directly from the king to his heir. And this is what it says. It says, "There are some horrible crimes that ye are bound in conscience never to forgive, such as witchcraft, willful murder, incest, and sodomy." So he instructed his son never to forgive sodomy. Master told me one day I'd find peace in every way, but in search for the clue, wrong things I was bound to do. Keep my head to the sky for the clouds to tell me why. As I grew and with strength, Master kept me as I repeat.
The book of Proverbs, chapter 8, verse 8. All the words of my mouth are in righteousness. There is nothing forward or perverse in them. Ninth verse. They are all plain to him that understand, and right to them that find knowledge. Receive my instructions, and not silver, and knowledge rather than choice gold. For wisdom is better than rubies, and all the things that may be desired are not to be compared to it. 2 Ezra chapter 5 verse 1. Nevertheless, as concerning the token, behold, the days shall come that they which dwell upon the earth shall be taken in great numbers, and the way of truth shall be hidden, and the land shall be barren of faith. 2 Ezra chapter 5, verse 2. But iniquity shall increase above that which now thou seest, or that thou hast heard long ago. 2 Ezra chapter 5, verse 9. And the salt water shall be found in the sweet, and all friends shall destroy one another. Then shall wisdom hide itself, and understanding withdraw itself into his secret chamber. Yes, today we will be discussing this King James sodomy case. Nothing is going wrong. Everything is going correctly as it has been written. There's this great attack against the scriptures with these nuclear explosions of Hebrews chapter 13, verse 9, strange doctrines. You have these strange sayings, such as you have this individual stating that King James took 6 books out of the Bible, which there are 66 books in the Bible, which means this book represents 666. Just like it states in the book of Proverbs chapter 14, verse 15, concerning how the simple believe every word, which many have jumped on this bandwagon, okay, concerning stating that King James is a sodomite, which there is no concrete evidence to prove what they are saying. Also, the robots are stating that King James wrote the intelligence inside the scriptures, which is nothing but another big fat lie. Like it says in Proverbs chapter 14, 15, the simple believe every word. So let's get into this case concerning King James. The sodomy King James case. Let us keep in mind before we go forward, this is all about an evil agenda. Before we go into this King James sodomy case, let's give a little summary pertaining to King James. James Charles Stewart, other known as King James the First or the Fourth. King James, he was born in Scotland around June the 19th, 1566. He was tutored by a man named Bunchen. Mr. King James, he spoke fluent Greek, Latin, French, English, etc. November the 23rd, 1589, he married a woman by the name of Annie from Denmark, who he loved so dearly. King James and his wife Annie, they gave birth to 9 children, like Prince Henry and Prince Charles. So far, this does not sound like a sodomite. Point number one, and this is not about black and white, this is about the truth. King James, the real King James, was a brother. This is a picture of the original King James. Okay, this is taken from a book titled Shakespeare, Life and Times, a pictorial record by the author Ronald Machatfrey. Point number two, the original King James is a descendant from the house of the Stuarts. Point number three, the original real King James is also a relative descendant of the house of Tudor, which King Henry VIII is a descendant of the original real King James, who King Henry VIII is a descendant of King Henry VII, which King Henry VIII was a wicked man. Coming from this book titled Nature Knows No Color Line by the author J.A. Rogers, okay, on page 76, they give us one of the original images of King Henry VIII, which King James is a descendant of. You see, it's not about the truth anymore. It's about the weapons of mass deception. It's about trickery. It's about lies. It's about warlockism. It's about pride. It's about ego. It's about tying you up in this etymology game. Okay, it's about using semantics and trickery. It's about Proverbs chapter 17, verse 4, which states this. A wicked doer giveth heed to false lips, such as this lie of King James being a sodomite, this lie that King James wrote all the words inside the scripture, when King James did not write not one single word that's recorded in the scripture. And a liar giveth ear to a naughty tongue. So far, concerning what we have for the original true King James, okay, for November, if I'm not mistaken, the 23rd for 1589, the original true King James, he took him a wife by the name of Annie of Denmark. to be his queen. King James, he loved his wife, and he wrote beautiful poetry for her. Together, King James and his wife, Annie, they had 9 children. Like it states in the book of St. John, chapter 8, 32, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free, which Ray Higgins liked to quote, even though he doesn't tell the truth. Most so-called black people of my nation and the other nations, they are not dealing with the truth. They're dealing with lies. Most black people today in this 21st century, their whole life is a big fat lie, and they're looking for more lies to disguise their evil lusts, which in the final end of all this weapons of mass deception, we shall be ashamed in the end. But where did this doctrine came from? Where did this deception come from concerning how they are saying that King James, who had 9 kids and was married to a woman by the name of Annie, okay, who once lived in Denmark, where did this lie come from concerning how they are saying that King James was a sodomite? It came from this wicked, evil man, this demon, who went by the name of Sir Anthony Weldon. Sir Anthony Weldon, he was a demon, and he hated the brothers and sisters that were living in Scotland, England. Anthony Weldon also had a perpetuate hatred for the original King James as well. The original King James, he fired wicked so-called Anthony Weldon from the court when King James found certain writings of Anthony Wicked Weldon stating that the Scots are stinking people. He also slandered the Scots by saying they were fornicators. He also stated that their breath stink. Anthony Weldon also goes on continuing to assassinate King James' character as well as the Scots. He stated also, to marry the Scots like King James would be like marrying a dead body to be thrown into the ditch. So King James got rid of his wicked behind. King James fired his wicked behind from the court. And Anthony Weldon, he swore to seek vengeance on King James, okay, for firing him from the court. Anthony Weldon, he subsequently, he swore he would have his day, okay, of vengeance against King James for firing him. Weldon, he never confronted King James while he was living. He did a coward move, but he waited 25 years later. That's right, 25 years, okay, after King James had died and passed away. Yes, wicked, evil Anthony Weldon, okay? He never confronted King James while he was living on this issue. So he waited till the man died and passed away, where King James, the brother, can't defend himself. And this is all our people is running with, and many more. So he created this letter stating how King James was a effeminate and how he was interested in men. Also, moreover, wicked Anthony Weldon, he also waited until King James' son Charles I had been executed, okay, in 1649. Also, like I said before, wicked satanic Anthony Weldon, okay, he not only came to hate King James, okay, but also he had a racial hatred of the Scottish race for which King James sprang. So basically, what we have here today, we have the many deceivers resurrecting this satanic, evil, demonic lie, okay, from Sir Anthony Weldon concerning how they falsely accused King James, who was married to a sister by the name of Annie, who had 9 kids, okay, of being a sodomite. You see, this situation ain't no different than the situation that occurred in the 1970s when they falsely accused our sister, Donna Summers, of being a man. You see, this situation ain't no different than them accusing, okay, Malcolm X of being a sodomite. This situation ain't no different when they falsely accused Big Daddy Kane, the rapper, of having AIDS in the year of the 1980s. You see, it's all about an evil agenda. And 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 3 explains, "For the time will come, and the time has come, when they will not endure sound doctrine," meaning the truth, telling the truth, the whole entire truth, "but after their own lust," which is lies, pride, deception, zeitgeist, okay, Egyptology, "shall they heap to themselves teachers, having itchy ears," fourth verse, "and they shall turn away their ears from the truth, and shall be turned unto fables, unto lies, unto deception." Just like this deceitful archaeologist by the name of John Allegros, he stated how the King of Kings, who they falsely call Christ, for instance, is far from being a real person, is now shown to be merely another name for the drug plant, the mushroom. Like Revelation chapter 12, verse 9 states how Satan, the invisible demon, was gonna deceive the whole world by using tactics such as saying that King James was a sodomite. There's a man by the name of Sir Henry Wotton who lived during the time when King James was alive. Sir Henry Wotton, who was a contemporary of King James, in commenting, and he commented upon King James' character, King James' reign in Scotland. Wotton, he makes this comment about King James' moral character. Okay, Henry Wotton, he stated, "King James was an admirable quality in his chastity, which he has preserved without blemish." Sir Henry Wotton also stated, "Unlike his predecessors who disturbed the kingdom by leaving many bastards," because there was a lot of wicked people that came after King James, just like King Henry VIII was wicked, just like Diocletian was wicked, just like Septimus Severus was wicked, just like a lot of us here today is gonna continue to promote these wicked satanic lies. There's another man by the name of Sir William Sanderson. He lived during the time when King James was the King of England. And he also spoke on the account of this deceitful lie concerning King James being a sodomite. Sir William N. Sanderson was a historian as well. Sir William Sanderson, okay, 1586 to 1676, he was another historian of the era who defended King James, okay, against his accuser. He penned a complete history of the lives and reign of Mary and King James, reconciling several opinions in vindication of him against two scandalous authors, as we stated before, Anthony Weldon, the demon liar. Don't forget that name, Anthony Weldon. And, okay, Wilson was another demon liar. He commented, "There, but infectionists have poisoned others who willfully," just like it says in 2 Peter the 3rd chapter, "they willfully today want to be ignorant concerning the truth, who willfully and maliciously," okay, "they have now very lately spit their venom in print, as if the world had been more than since half a hundred years last past abuse. With a false and feigned story," he calls, okay, Anthony Weldon's work, Sir William Sanderson stated, "Anthony Weldon's work is traitorous, okay, intentions, and him a pamphleteer of fables." Sanders further defends James, that's right, Brother King James, and Alicius, yes, his Alicius co-quinary, calling Weldon's, okay, a diatribe, a false story. And that's all this is. This is a lie, okay? This is deception, to mislead the people and push the people away from the Father to bring in an evil agenda. Let us remember, King James had many enemies. They hated King James because it was against what King James was doing. There's another enemy by the name of Fawkes. That's F-A-W-K-E-S. He was under the direction of the Jesuit, okay? And he was set up to put 36 barrels of gunpowder in the parliament to blow it up to kill King James. King James, he survived many attempt assassins on his life. During the rulership of King James, okay, there was no more war. You see? These are all lies. He brought the brothers and sisters together and taught them not to war and fight against each other. You see, this is the same old game of Nimrod and the Samaritan kingdom. Okay? And it's called telling big fat lies. Big fat lies. Telling big fat lies. Okay? So here they are continuing assassinating King James' character. And King James did not write not one single word that's inside the scriptures. There's a difference with being the author and authorizing something. When you're authorizing something, you're in the position of power, giving the other party the permission to do such thing, such as the 47 intelligent scholars that was well versed in history and the language of Greek and Latin and Aramaic to do the translation. So what we're dealing with here today really is the time of the great apostasy. This is the time of supreme deception. This is the time of supreme wickedness. This is the time of supreme lies. This is the time of supreme immorality. This is the time of supreme witchcraft. This is the time of supreme murder. You see, we're in that time. It was already foretold. So it's going to go down like that. And many of the people of my nation is going to follow the lie. They're going to keep following the lie. As it has been written, they must fulfill. And many more people of the other nations as well. You see, there's only very few true seekers that's on this earth here today. The majority is going to continue to use the same old Zeiss guy, the same old Helena Blavatsky, okay? The same old Maxwell Jordan, okay? The same old Anton LaVey, okay? The same old Nimrod tactics until there shall be no more. King James wrote several books. The Basilicon Doron, which was really a book that was supposed to be dedicated to his son, who is supposed to be the heir to continue the kingship when he died. And in this book called the Basilica Doron, okay, this is what King James is addressing, okay, to his heir before King James passed away. This is the instruction, the counsel that he gave to his heirs. He says, in this book called the Basilica Doron, in this book, he stated, but the principal blessing is in your marrying of a godly and virtuous wife, just like it states in the book of Hebrews 13:4, how marriage is honorable and the bed is undefiled. He continues stating, being flesh of your flesh and bone of your bone. So King James, okay, he exalted marriage. He honored marriage. Don't sound like a Bati man. Don't sound like a Chichi man to me. Okay? He stated, marriage is the greatest earthly felicity. Without the blessings of the Almighty Father, which they falsely call God, you cannot look for a happy marriage. So King James esteemed marriage. King James exalted marriage. And he gave this counsel to his heirs to marry a virtuous woman. A woman of integrity, a woman of moralistic values, a woman that respect the Almighty Father, Ancient of Days. He also stated to keep your body clean and unpolluted while you give it to your wife, whom to only it belongs, for how can you justly crave to be joined with a virgin if your body be polluted? So King James was promoted righteous, imperial, moralistic values, not Christianity, not religion, okay, not what these liars are stating, okay. He says marriage is one of the greatest actions that a man does all his time. When you are married, keep inviolably your promise made to the Almighty Father in your marriage. In other words, you're not to have a divorce until death do you part, especially Eschew means to hate, to be effeminate, meaning immorality, fornication, adultery, and sodomy. King James also stated in his book that he wrote called the Basilicon, Doron, to know and love the Almighty Father Creator, who they falsely call God. He also stated the whole scriptures is dedicated by the Almighty Father Creator of the universe, not no God. He also stated a good king to establish good laws among your people, the others by your behavior in your own person with your servants. King James continues stating in this book called Basilicon Doron, which he wrote to his heirs, he stated, there are some horrible crimes that ye are bound in conscience never to forgive, such as witchcraft, willful murder, incest, and sodomy. Abstain from the filthy vice of adultery. Remember only what solemn promise ye made to the Almighty Father at your marriage. Does not sound like a funny man to me. All they're going to do is make up another lie against the Basilicon Doron, pertaining to the scrolls of Enoch, which was written during the time of the 6th and 7th century, during the ancient Babylonian Nebuchadnezzar's captivity, rulership, and reign, and prior before. It informs us, pertaining to how there will come a time that there will be a nuclear explosion of lies, just like these scrolls are addressing. Woe to you who do godless acts, and they praise and honor lies. You shall perish, and no happy life shall be yours. Yes, the truth shall prevail in the end. The Scrolls of Enoch, chapter 98, verse 15, which states exactly what they're doing here today. Woe to you who write down lying and godless words. Yeah, they're writing all these lies in these books, and they're flooding the market with all these deceitful books, these lies, these fables, these mythologies. And they put these lies in these books, and you have our people and the other people of the other nation using these deceitful demonic books, okay, to try to fight against the truth, which in the final end, they're going to lose and they're going to be ashamed. Woe to you who write down lying and godless words. For they write down their lies, their plagiarization lies. For they write down their lies. They got books out there saying that the only people that cannot exist is the Hebrews and Abraham. For they write down their lies so that men may hear them. And men are repeating these lies, just like that DVD Zeiss guy lie, which many have jumped on the bandwagon. And the new lie today is that the Romans wrote the New Testament. Give them 3 to 4 weeks, okay, to the next month, they're going to have another brand new lie against the scripture. And the next month after that, they're going to keep on making up brand new lies against the scriptures. Woe to you who write down lying and godless words. For they write down their lies so that men may hear them. So they're here to deceive people. They don't care about the people and act godlessly. What is this godlessly? Reason why a lot of people like these lies, because they want to continue to fornicate. They're hiding behind these lies because they like fornication and adultery and one night stand and smoking those stink blunts. That's what this is really about. It's about rebelling and maintaining wickedness. It's not about the truth. They write down their lies so that men may hear them. And they also go to and fro to deceive other people with their lies. Inside these books, and there's a nuclear explosion of lies on that internet as well. Because there's a lot of lies on that internet computer as well with partial truth. For they write down their lies. They went from plagiarization to astrology lies to even say that Nimrod doesn't exist for the simple fact the Babylonian Empire existed before the Egyptian Empire. For they write down their lies so that men may hear them and act godlessly towards their neighbor. Therefore they shall have no peace, but die a sudden death. Consequences for telling lies. Let us continue to expect the lies to continue. To continue to explode like a nuclear bomb. Just like it states in the book of 1 Timothy 4 verse 1 and 2. These are doctrines that demons must come and teach before this is all over. such as this big fat lie, how they still are proclaiming that the intelligence in the scriptures is a copycat of the so-called Africans' understanding, the so-called Samaritan kingdom, the so-called Egyptian kingdom. Even though when you read into the Samaritan so-called laws, if a man rapes a woman, okay, the punishment was not death, okay, he had to marry that woman. Even though Deuteronomy chapter 22 verse 25 gives us a perfect example of the correct moralistic consequences for a man that rapes a woman. Even though this case is dealing with a betrothed married damsel, okay, the consequences of a raper is not that he is given the opportunity to marry, okay, the victim that he raped, but his head's supposed to be put to bed. His light's supposed to be put out. So this is wickedness. So this is what we're dealing with. Demons, which are evil or unclean spirits that are living inside the physical body of many of these liars that are walking on this earth here today. But this is another tactic that the evil deceivers and the demons are using, okay, walking in the flesh on this earth here today. But the next popular tactic that the deceivers, okay, whose bodies are being controlled by demons are using here today, they go into the etymology term of the English term demon, which comes from the Greek word daimon, a source of Latin, which means divine power, faith, God. This is a bunch of hogwash, okay? We're dealing with evil forces. We're dealing with the invisible world. This is basic common knowledge, okay? Or rather was basic common knowledge in the ancient world. Just like it says in Colossians chapter 2, verse 8. Be aware, lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit. This is vain deceit to get you all tied up in this etymology game to evade and avoid the real issue of the matter. This is a form of sorcery and witchcraft. We're dealing with demons, evil spirits, unclean spirits that are living inside the physical body of man, woman, and child, using their physical anatomy to bring forth their last triumph of this weapon of mass great deception. There's only one devil, okay, which is dealing with the invisible evil forces, but myriads of demons who serve the evil force known as the devil in English and make his power practically universal. A demonic person is a person whose personality has been invaded. And a lot of people of our nation, they might have been invaded and the other nations with these deceitful evil spirits. That's why they can't help and stop telling lies. And these evil, satanic, ancient, invisible demonic forces, they are attracted to pride, arrogancy, and lies. So pretty much, when you're a liar, when you're proud and arrogancy, that's pretty much an invitation for these evil forces to come inside your physical anatomy and use you like a Lamborghini. And when they finish with you, they're going to pretty much toss you in the garbage can when the mission is over. You see, a demonic person is a person whose personality has been invaded by one or more demons who at will can speak and act through their human victims, deranging both his mind and body. That's pretty much what's going on. These people are deranged through their pride. That's an invisible satanic force that they have invited inside of them that is using a physical anatomy to promote all these satanic lies. Just like the so-called atheists, okay, so-called Negro in Atlanta, Georgia, they're saying, I don't find the intelligence in the scriptures to be creditable. Just like so-called Maxwell Jordan, okay, have promoted this lie stating, there's no truth whatsoever in the New Testament. I find that quite ironic because when you read Revelation chapter 16 and 12, it explains how the waters in the Euphrates rivers is drying up as we speak right now. When you read the book of Job, chapter 26, verse 7, it explains how this earth that we walk on every day is spinning in space. When you read Genesis, chapter 11, verse 5 and 6, it speaks about how we shall be speaking these different languages. When you read Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 1, it speaks about the Hittites and the Canaanites. And there's archaeology to prove that they did exist. When you read Ecclesiastes in the Apocrypha, chapter 37, verse 29 and verse 30, it speaks about the high consumption of eating meat can lead to colon cancer. Ecclesiastes chapter 37, verse 29 to 30 is giving us the proper application of the correct health practices to avoid getting colon cancer. Ain't talking about no stupid religion. Psalms 116:11 states how all men are liars that do not tell the truth. And that's exactly what's happening. Proverbs 14:15 explains how the simple-minded one believe every word, the plagiarization, the Maxwell Jordan, all these lies that's being used against the scriptures, the Ray Hagen lies, the Helena Blavatsky resurrected lies, the Babylonian lies. But the wise man look well to his going. The wise man will consider and investigate and not be proud and arrogant. Like it says in Proverbs chapter 22 and 22, it pretty much explains how you're not supposed to rob a poor man because he is poor, because he don't have nothing. Neither oppress the afflicted and the gays. This is not talking about no religion or Christianity. It's talking about righteous moralistic values. You jump to the 27th verse. It states, if thou hast nothing to pay, why should he take away thy bed? Like putting a man's house into foreclosure. Ain't talking about no stupid plagiarization. This is the ignorance and the wickedness of man. So the conclusion is this, as 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 1 explains, how in our time there will come false prophets, just like Harold Camping, and there's more to come, and many false teachers. Basically, you're going to see more liars jump on the bandwagon of telling more lies. Okay, they're going to hatch just like a cockroach hatching inside your house. Just like it stated in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 3, it speaks about in our times, there will rise up many scoffers against the Creator, saying the Creator don't exist, saying the intelligence in the scriptures is not valid, saying that Abraham never existed, saying that Adam never existed, saying that the only people in biblical ancient time that cannot exist because we say so is the Hebrew Israelites. Everybody else can exist except the Hebrews. And at the end of the chapter, the final conclusion to this matter will be, as Ecclesiastes chapter 10 verse 3 explains, yeah, also when he that is a fool walk by the way, his wisdom faileth him, and he saith to everyone that he is a fool with consequences. Like it says in Revelation 12 and 9, how Satan was going to deceive the whole world pertaining to with this great, weapons of mass deception, how they are stating that Noah's Ark never existed, the flood never existed, it was a fairy tale, it was a mythology, it was all made up, Noah never existed, the Hebrews never existed. But when you go back to the reports, going back to 1973 for September, pertaining to the CIA, so-called CIA reports, pertaining to the satellite photographs that they took of a purportedly boat, like an object, on Mount Ararat in September of 1973. And they are changing their tune pertaining to what they discovered in 1973, pertaining to the archaeologist's evidence of the remains of Noah's Ark, which rests on Mount Ararat, Turkey. You go back to this man by the name of Ron Wyatt and David, for Seoul. For the year of 1980, they also did an excavation, in the area of Turkey. And this is what they saw. This is what they found. And they concluded they saw an ark resting on Mount Ararat with crisscross lines of iron pertaining to this ark, which they are denying, okay, did not exist. You go back to the excavation, okay, for Noah's Ark for the year of 2008. There was a man by the name of Ahmet Ertuğrul, leaders of the search for Noah's Ark, okay, and he stated, I got to know the secret location in June 2008. Okay, the source told me, let's continue, I took a team there for the search around the region, okay, in the location of Mount Ararat in Turkey, and I found a wooden structure. I took some photographs of the interior of what was remaining pertaining to Noah's Ark, which was sitting, okay, on the mountain of Ararat, which Genesis, the 6th chapter, speaks upon, which is known today as Turkey. And this is an image of the man by the name of Ahmet Ertuğrul, okay, who took his excavation, okay, in Turkey, Mount Ararat, for the year of 1980. And this is him inside what remains of the Ark, and he took photographs. But it was already foretold. The Most High warned us about how liars and deceivers would intensify and how they were falsely transformed in an angel of light, deceiving the masses, as 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 13 foretold. There's another man by the name of Crawford who took himself on a archaeological, okay, excavation in search for Noah's Ark. Crawford, he made numerous climbs up to Ararat in 1990. And this is what he discovered. He discovered, Mr. Crawford, he discovered a large rectangular structure buried in the ice on Mount Ararat, Turkey, at an elevation of 14,765 feet. Mr. Crawford stated, he said the structure of the remains of Noah's Ark, which they are denying, just like they supposed to do, he said it sits under the snow and ice. Mr. Crawford, he puts much of his discovery online at a website called Project Von Bora, which I will not be surprised if they took down that information. Also, Crawford stated that if you think somebody went up, okay, on the top of the mountain, okay, on Mount Ararat to build this ark, he said it would take a much more greater miracle than the flood that's recorded in Genesis, the 6th chapter. Also, there's a man by the name of Taylor. Mr. Taylor, he says, the photos suggested its length to the width ratio is close to 6.1 as indicated in the book of Genesis. There's a lieutenant by the name of Valdemir. In the summer thaw of 1916, Lieutenant Valdemir of the Russian Imperial Armed Forces, he spotted a half-submerged ship embedded in a frozen lake on the side of Mount Ararat, Turkey, during one of the highest altitudes during Valdemir's mission. He also described, okay, how he saw a large doorway on the side of this ark while attending his search for Noah's Ark to see whether or not this is a myth or a fairy tale. Also, he compared the ark to a battleship. Also, when he went inside the ark, he stated that he saw small rooms inside the ark, tires of cages, which they confirm that the wood was Olinder, which belongs to the Cypress family, and it never rotted. After the Communist Revolution, the following year, the trail goes cold, and all communications and photographs are untraceable. Maybe today they lie in a top secret Kremlin vault. So it's not about the truth anymore.